So interaction in field theory, in Lagrangian field theories are represented by operators, local operators, that involves higher powers of the fields, at least three or more fields. Because this will lead to non-linear equation of motions, which cannot be solved like we did. So to best give you an idea of how interaction work, first in classical theory and then in quantum theory, just let me use a simple example of a real stellar field, the mass m, and let's put an interaction, a quartic interaction, lambda phi to the 4. So for convenience, let me normalize the coefficient this way. First of all, when you start writing a dimension operator, you can track the dimensions of the coefficients in front by noticing that. So the general rule is that you start looking at the kinetic term. Since the Lagrangian density has dimension 4 in energy, the kinetic term fixes the energy of the field, the dimension of the field, in this case dimension 1. Then you go to your interaction term. This is dimension 5 to the 4, is dimension 4, which means that the coefficient is dimensionless. If the dimensionality of the operator was different in terms of powers of fields, then the dimensions of the prefactor, the coefficient, would be either dimension, would be dimensionful, either dimension larger than 1 or less than 1. And this is a very important information, the dimension of the prefactor, because it tells you a lot of how the interaction behaves with energy. Okay, so the equation of motion is simple in this case to derive. We have the terms that comes from the free part and plus a term that comes from there. If you take the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to phi, you get lambda phi cube equal to 0. So these are our equation of motion. So for these equations, this equation are not, so the general solution to this equation is not known. There are some solutions known. For example, when you have a negative mass, one we found in the exercise, there was this domain wall solution. This is a particular solution, but the most general solution is not known, which means that if I give you some initial non-trivial initial condition for your Cauchy problem, and I ask you how the field evolves, you won't be able to actually reconstruct analytically what is actually the solution, okay? With those boundary conditions, those okay. Initial conditions.
Can you tell that this equation is not integrable? That's why.
Yeah, I don't know if I will connect the two dots. So, what do we do? We give up? Of course, of course. One thing is that numerically you can solve it, right? You can write a code in your computer, you write an initial condition, and all you have to do is just to integrate numerically this equation. You can write this phi in terms of, this will give you the second derivative of phi in terms of the field phi. So knowing the initial condition, you can do step by step and evolve in time your initial condition numerically. Another option is if lambda is a small parameter. If lambda is small, then you can treat this as a perturbation and integrate iteratively this equation. So let's assume this is the case. Then at the first, so I can write phi without lack of generality as phi naught plus phi 1. And phi naught, by definition, is the solution to the free equation of motion. Then I take this combination here, phi naught plus phi 1, and I put it inside my original equation. And I find an equation for phi 1, right? Box plus m squared phi naught plus phi 1 must be equal or plus lambda phi naught plus phi 1 cube must be equal to 0. So far I didn't do anything, I just put phi divided in 2. If you want, this is the definition of phi 1. Phi 1 is phi, not, phi minus phi naught, where phi naught is the solution to the free equation. I put it in, and this is a condition of, is an equation now on phi 1. Here I have box plus m squared, phi naught is 0 by definition. So here I get only this piece. And here I have plus lambda phi naught cube plus dot 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 equal to 0. So you see from here that the solution to phi 1, if I invert this, will be proportion to lambda, because all the pieces here are proportion to lambda. So phi 1 in size will be, as you will be suppressed by lambda, which is a small parameter. So all the dots here are higher power of phi 1, so higher power of lambda. So at leading order in the lambda expansion, I can neglect them, because it will give me pieces that are at least lambda squared or lambda cube. And I get an equation now for phi 1 in terms of lambda phi naught squared. Phi naught is, I know, because it's a solution to the free equation. And now this equation is nothing else than the Klein-Gordon equation with an external source, which I can also solve. So the solution for phi 1 is then, let me just write it as I lambda, the integral dd for y of g x minus y. And here I put the source, and the source is minus lambda phi naught cube, so it's here I have a phi naught cube of y.
There is phi iota lambda. And in the start. In the start it is phi iota lambda.
Sorry,
cool. The phi 1 is equal to the factor before the integral.
I lambda.
I lambda, okay. Lambda.
And this is valid up to order lambda squared. Okay. So I get a solution for phi, which is valid up to order lambda squared. If I want to know what is the higher order terms, all I have to do is to repeat just the same exercise. I can write this as phi naught plus phi 1 plus phi 2. I take this, I put it inside here. Now I know phi naught and phi 1. Here I got box plus m squared of phi 2 plus a combination of phi naught and phi 1. Because of this lambda, I don't keep phi 2, which will be higher order. I only have phi naught and phi 1s with some powers. And then again, I have an equation, which is the Klein-Gordon equation with an external source, which now depends on phi naught and phi 1. So I can obtain phi 2 in terms of, let's say, phi 1 cube plus phi naught. I remember, okay. So phi 2 will be of the form something disproportion to lambda, for example, square, some integral, and then there will be two powers of g, and phi naught.
next couple of weeks.
So in principle you can go on as much as you want, depending on the precision you want to reach on your solution, and depending on how big lambda is. The smaller lambda, the least number of steps you have to perform if you want to reach a certain precision.
Actually, you are partial view. It's like partial vision.
Huh?
It's like partial vision.
This is perturbation. So in other words, you just take phi, just write it as a sum lambda to the n from n to 0 to infinity of phi n. Take these answers, you plug inside the original Lagrangian, you expand in lambda, and you match lambda by lambda each term, and then you solve. So this is how you will do in classical field theory to solve the equation of motion perturbative. This is for example how you do in Maxwell equation in electrodynamics if you want to solve a problem distribution of charge and with the self interaction. Okay? Now, what happens at the quantum level when we try to quantize the theory? Well, if you remember, at the quantum level, phi naught had a structure that inside phi naught, from this equation, there will be a combination of A and daggers. So, if you repeat the same procedure and then you quantize, what you'll find that, for example, phi 1 will not have only A and daggers, but since it involves the cubic power of phi naught, we'll have also terms which are a cube, a dagger square a dagger square, so all the possible combinations, right? A cube, a dagger a square, a dagger square, and a dagger cube terms. So after you put this inside phi, it means the original phi solution of the graphic of the equation of motion will have a representation which is like which have A daggers plus 10 which are lambda suppressed which are of order A cube plus 10 which are lambda square which are of order A to the 5 and so on. A daggers combination. So which means that phi itself now doesn't just create an electron particle, but it can create n particle states and annihilate n particle states. A similar argument apply also to the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian will be built from the Lagrangian in the usual way. In the free case, remind you that the Hamiltonian, because the Lagrangian is quadratic, is also quadratic in the field, which means the Hamiltonian was just a collection of a dagger A's, which means that the unitary evolution for the generic state is just of the form e to the I some integral of a dagger A's, but this was the number operator. So for a generic state with a fixed number of particles n, the evolution was just a phase. So the evolution was pretty simple, just a phase rotation on the state of the Fock space. But now, when you add interaction, this is no longer true. First of all, in the Hamiltonian, there will be also terms which are over the phi to the 4, beside the phi square 1, coming from this term here. And moreover, it, the phi, which is solution to the equation of motion, will also have an arbitrary large power of creation and relation operators. So in the Hamiltonian, there will be term of the form a dagger a, but there will be also term of order a dagger cube a, or a dagger to the phi a, and so on. Of course, the more a's, powers of a dagger you have, the more powers of lambda they will come with. So that if lambda is small, there will be smaller and smaller effect. But this means that in the evolution of the general state, the evolution will be now involve also higher powers of A daggers. And in general, you could have terms that do not conserve the number of particles. For example, you could have terms that annihilate one particle and create three particles. Or the opposite, annihilate three particles and create only one. So in, whenever you have interaction, you could, for example, start at time equal to zero with a state of two particles, and as time evolves, you evolve with the unitary transformation, which is the Hamiltonian itself, you end up in general with a superposition of two particle state plus four particle state plus six particle states, and so on, as long as energy is conserved. So generically, you end up with a state which is a linear superposition of n particle state. And this is because in the interaction case, the number operator does not commute with the Hamiltonian. Only in the free theory, the number operator commutes with the Hamiltonian, so the number of particles are conserved. But whenever you switch on interaction, generically what happens is that the number operator do not commute with the Hamiltonian anymore. And the number of particles are not conserved. You can start creating particles, or particles can annihilate and disappear, or decay. In particular, the state at any given time is not an eigenstate of the particle, the number of particles operator. A similar thing we saw already when we added the source, the classical source coupled to the free field. In that case, we could solve exactly the system. We saw that from the source, we start creating particles. Now, here is the field itself that is sourcing the interaction, through the interaction, other particles. Of course, eventually, we want to write a field theory that describes all we see. So there will be no external sources we have by hand, but the sources are inside the theory itself, represented by other fields.
This method works only lambda is less than 1.
Yeah, of course, only if lambda is less than 1, well, much less than 1, then in this writing of the series representation, you can truncate this series to a finite order and have a good approximation of the final result. If lambda is large, truncating this here, computing only a finite number of terms will not give you any good approximation of the final result. So in those cases, when the coupling is large, this middle perturbation theory will not work. Then the only resource is to just compute numerically. Of course, in the classical case, you just have to integrate numerically, which is simple in general to do. In quantum case, it's much harder because in quantum theory, the Hilbert space is infinitely bigger than the classical phase space, which means that maybe with quantum computing, but at the moment, even not. So there are other methods to actually solve non-perturbatively quantum field theories numerically. Or maybe you can find other parameters to expand on. It's another technique sometimes is used. Not the coupling itself, it's the coupling large, but some other parameters. But in this theory, there are not much other parameters, but in more complicated theory, you could have other parameters.
Like what?
Possibility is the number of fields. So,
how so?
I can show that in the limit of large number of fields, there is an effective coupling which is small, even if the coupling you write seems to be large.
And coupling between what?
The interaction coupling between... It requires a lecture by itself. There's a particular limit you can do for which you have a small parameter you can expand. Questions? Okay, so now we'll concentrate a little bit more, since I have to give a meaning to the title of the course, to the QED interactions. But most of what I will say is more general application. So for QED, we can write now a theory with interaction that we wrote last time already. We have the Kennedy term for the photon. Then we can add a field for the electron. Then the mass here will be the mass of the electron. And a coupling that will come from the coherent energy of the electron between the photon and the electron. This term also has dimension 4 in energy, because the fermion has dimension 3/2, square 3. Photon is dimension 1, 4. So the prefactor is dimensionless, like for lambda 5 to the 4. So it's a pure number. And it's the electric charge of the electron, which measure how strongly the electron coupled to the photon. You can easily add extra particles. For example, you can add a muon. Now this mu is the muon, it's not in the Lorentz index. You will have a different mass. And it happens that he has the same electric charge as the electron.
That would be psi bar in the first term of muon.
Yes, thank you. And you can add, for example, if you want to describe also, for example, quarks, you can add a fermion for the quark, see, with the mass of the quark. And here to add the charge of the quark, which is now different from the one of the electron. And it happens to be either 2/3 or minus 1/3, depending if the quark is up or down type. could also add a field for the proton, if you want.
Shouldn't it be
for the helium?
Huh? Shouldn't it be -2/3 or +1/3? Or
it probably should. Thank you.
Because in the
because I already put the plus for the electron. Yes.
Because in the Hamiltonian it will change the sign.
Yeah, in the Hamiltonian will change the sign, but the overall sign you can choose whatever you want.
Yeah.
Because these terms are defined up to phase. But the relative sign between the electron and the quark is fixed. I could have chosen here minus. These are fixed. Okay. Okay. So. Okay, so this is our starting Lagrangian. We have three parts and some interaction. For this course, I will most use the interaction feature to describe interactions. So, what means is that our Hamiltonian, that derived from this Lagrangian, will be divided in two pieces, H0 and H1. H0 will be the Hamiltonian in the absence of this interaction term, the free one we already computed in the previous lectures. And H1 is basically just this term here. In the interaction picture, remember that all the fields are evolving time with the Hamiltonian H0. So all the fields will be the solution to the classical to the field equation of the free Hamiltonian, the free Lagrangian. So it are exactly those that we computed already. So we have psi t and x, the exactly the expression we computed, and same for the photon. And all the effect of the interactions will be instead will appear as an evolution of the states of the system. And the interaction is, the interaction Hamiltonian is just the these operators in the interaction feature, which means these are the operators where there is a time dependence dictated by the free Hamiltonian. So the expression we computed of all the fields in terms of creation and addition operator will hold. And all the interaction will show up in the evolution of the states.
In the last term, where you included the quarks in the branching.
Yes.
Can we also multiply it by 3 because of 3 colors of the quarks?
No.
No, just the last term.
No. What you should do for the quarks, for the colors of the quark, is the fact that there are actually 3 fields for each quark.
Yes.
So there is an extra index here, which run over from 1 to 3. And same here. There are really three independent fields, three independent particles for each quark.
And
exactly the same charge.
Now are we considering the quarks in the high energy limit, because in that limit the effect of strong interactions can be neglected?
For the moment I'm just, I didn't put gluons.
Yeah.
So there are no strong interactions. If I wanted to describe the quarks completely, I should also add their interaction, weak interaction and strong interactions, also for the electron, and the low energies, strong interaction become large.
So here we are assuming that the mass in each doublet is the same.
The mass of?
Of each doublet is the same.
Doublet.
On quarks.
Quarks. You mean triplet? -2/3 and 1/3?
Yeah,
no, it should be different. So this Q can be up or down, so M up will be different from M down.
Okay.
Okay, other questions? Okay, so our interaction Hamiltonian then will be minus e, because it will be minus the Lagrangian, the integral in d3x of psi bar a slash psi. Okay? For each species. Now it's concentrated only on the electron, so I only have to write too many indices. Okay, so because of this, then the evolution of a generic state will be governed by this equation. I d in dt of psi a of t then is what? Is h1 okay, this is the Schrödinger equation, basically, for the state A of t, which evolved in the interaction picture with just H1 Hamiltonian. Okay, now we have to solve this equation. Let me solve it in this way. So let me integrate left and right hand side. In two times, so let me write that a of t is equal to a of 0, so integrate this between 0 and t, minus I put I on the other side, and then I integrate this, so the integral of this just give me the integral between 0 and t of h1 of t prime, a of t prime.
Dt prime. Dt prime.
Yes, thank you. So, of course, you might complain. But I really didn't integrate this, solve this equation, because on the right hand side, I still have a of t. But I'm very persistent, so I keep going. And now I write this as a0 minus I integral between 0 and t in dt prime. And then I substitute here the same solution. So I have h1 of t prime a0 plus I squared the integral in dt1, dt2, 0 and t2. Sorry, t, between 0 and t1, of h1 t1, h1 t2, a t2. I did a small progress. Now the first two terms are in terms of the original state. The last is still the unknown one, but I can continue forever. And if I continue forever, I can rewrite the full expression as a sum over n from 0 to infinity, or minus I to the n, the integral between 0 and t in dt1, integral 0 and t1 in dt2, integral 0 and t n minus 1 in dtn of the product of h1 t1 h1 tn of a 0. And I got rid of a of t. Okay?
You can also make the upper limit the same by dividing by n factorial. You can also make upper limits of all the integrals the same by dividing by n factorial.
Yeah, I haven't finished it. Okay, so this is the formal solution to this equation. It's an infinite series of all these terms. You can check that if you take this, you plug inside this expression. Very easy to check. But I haven't finished. I want to manage a little bit more this expression. Here I have a product of h1 t1, h1 tn. But if you see from this integral, t1 is always bigger than t2, t2 is always bigger than t3, until tn minus 1 is always bigger than tn. Which means that t1 is always in the future of t2, which is in the future of t3, which is in the future of tn. Which means that this product is actually the same as the time order product of all these guys. Okay? So I can rewrite it as a time order product. But now if you write it as a time order product, I can flip the order of these guys and nothing will change. Because at the end, I have to take the time order product. The time order product of AB is equal to the time order product of BA, if A and B are bosonic operator, like in this case. Which means that this function here, as a function of T1 to Tn, is a symmetric, completely symmetric function under the permutation of T1 Tn. And now I can use this fact that I'm integrating this completely symmetric function of T1 Tn to rewrite this n integral in a completely symmetric fashion as the integral between 0 and t in dt1, integral between 0 and t in dt2, integral between 0 t in dtn over n factorial. Since I can exchange now t1 with ti with ti, tj, each of this integral as I want, I can integrate them all between 0 and t, but then of course the domain of integration is n factorially bigger, so I have to divide by 1 over n factorial. Okay, now you can recognize in this sum, in this series, actually the series of an exponential. You have factor to the n, 1 over n factorial, then you have n integral that are all the same, and factors of h1, hn. Okay? So this is also equal to the time order product of e to the minus I, the integral in dt prime, of h1 t prime between 0 and t applied to the state a naught. Okay? So if you expand this, clearly get this. So this time order product put in front, it means that this is a shorthand notation for that expression. So it means that when you write this in series, each term you take the term order product. And this is nothing else than our unitary evolution operator, u of t, which indeed map the state at time equal to 0 to the state at time t. So it's very similar to the one you already know in quantum mechanics, except that because in general in this case the interaction Hamiltonian do not commute with the Hamiltonian interaction at different time, you have to be careful to take the time of the problem. Okay, so now that we have at least a formal expression for the evolution of the state, A of t, then you can define general observation of what's the probability that some process happen by just taking the modulus square of any state B at some time t with the state A at the time t squared, where A of t is just u of t with naught. So this gives you the probability to transit from the state A at time 0 to the state B at time t. Just have to take now the matrix element of this unitary matrix between two different states. This is exactly like in normal quantum mechanics. Of course, we can define the same object between two different times, t2 and t1. Then you can define this guy between t2 and t1. Okay, it's useful at this point to define a special object, which is this probability, a special limit, which is the limit where t1 goes to minus infinity and t2 goes to plus infinity. Which means the probability that a state in the infinite past becomes a different state in the infinite future. Okay? This is nothing else than the matrix element between two different states at minus infinity and plus infinity of this operator computed at t1 equal to minus infinity and t2 equal to plus infinity. So this object is called the S-matrix. If you want, it's just the limit of t2 that goes to plus infinity, t1 equals to minus infinity of u of t2 to 1. Which then becomes the time order product of e to the minus I, the integral of h1 to minus infinity and plus infinity in dt. Now, let's write h1 explicitly, that here I erased. If you do that, this is also equal to the time order product of e to the minus I, integral in dt, integral in d dx, and now here integrating over all time and all space of the interaction Hamiltonian, which is e, which I write here, psi bar a slash psi. But this is also nothing else than the integral in d4x of this object. And this object is a scalar operator. And the integral in d4x of a scalar operator is a Lorentz invariant. So from here you find that the S matrix is a Lorentz invariant. This is of course not the case if you didn't take these limits. If you didn't take the limits t minus infinity plus infinity, then you're computing the probability amplitude between two time slices. And of course, two time slices are not Lorentz invariant. If you do a boost, you can change the orientation of these time slices. only after taking the limit of time goes to plus infinity and minus infinity, this object here becomes Lorentz invariant. And this simplifies a lot of the calculation, because then you can use the full Lorentz symmetry to write the result. Also, it's important thing that the matrix is Lorentz invariant, so the matrix elements will be Lorentz invariant only if you take, you construct your matrix element with the creation relation operator that whose norm are Lorentz invariant. So the A tildes or C tildes that I described. If you use the state to create states, the one that have not this normalization, for example, the one that has a field is normalized with D3P over 2 pi cube 1 over 2 omega p with the root, which are commutation relation was simpler in a sense. If you use the n particle state created by these guys, and you take those states matrix element in S, then this matrix will not be Lorentz invariant, because these states are not covariant. So that's why I use always the other normality. Okay?
In this F matrix actually tells us that what is the probability of the field being in a state at infinitely past time to go into another state in infinitely past future. That's right. But suppose that we have a decaying particle, what is the meaning of that in infinitely past time?
Exactly, it's not well defined. In fact, the S matrix acts on the Fock space of states, as you may imagine, that are defined at time minus infinity plus infinity. Particles that are unstable do not belong to this Hilbert space. The Hilbert space is only formed by states that are unstable.
But the thing is that, using this definition of S matrix, when we calculate the formulas for the decay rates, those are also replicable for decaying particles, so why is that?
There is a problem. In fact, we will see. If you just, you are blind and use this, you try to define the decay rate with an S matrix, you find infinities. And then you need to interpret decay rates, because you define the S matrix as the infinite time limit, you have to make some tricks. What the trick tells you is that if you did this, if you want to sharply define a decay rate, starting from the S matrix, a particle that's decay, right? So imagine you have a particle here which decays in more particle there. Of course, this cannot live for infinite time because of the finite time, which means that this particle must be produced by some other process, or stable particle. So, unstable particles are only resonances in the S matrix. So you see the unstable particle only as a resonance in the S matrix from stable particles.
So is that
and that from there you can define a lifetime and a decay rate.
Because this state can be stretched to the infinity past time that it was created for two particles. So are these two particles unique for a particle?
No. The same state can be formed by any combination of stable particles which have exactly the same quantum numbers.
So do they give the same results for the decay rate or different results?
It depends on what you are computing. If you compute the total decay rate, yes. If you are computing some branch rate in some process, because the particle decays, typically can decay either in two particles, can decay in four particles, depends. So which means that it can be produced by two particles, can be produced by four particles, and so on. But anyway, we have a lecture on this kind of stuff, so I'll postpone the full discussion today. Okay, so this is the S matrix. Of course, by construction, since U is a unitary operator, and this matrix is unitary, so it satisfies the condition that the stagger S is equal to the identity, which means that the modulo square that arises from here can be considered a good probability, right? So it can be normalized to 1. Another object is also introduced, can write the S matrix as the identity plus IT. So what this is a definition of the T matrix. Why is this useful? Because you see that without interactions, this term will be zero. So the S matrix will be the identity. Nothing happens, right? So this T encode all what happens because of interactions. So this is another object that is often used, that we will use. Okay, this is just a definition. Now to make a comment on indeed something that what you said, which is what is the space, the inverse space, over which this S matrix acts. So this is the space of states, some of which you already saw, which are n-particle states, if you want, it's like the Fock space, but it's the Fock space that survives at plus infinity or minus infinity. The states that are basically survives at time equal to minus infinity, which is the Fock space at time equal to minus infinity, they are called in state. And as you may imagine, the states that lives at time equal to plus infinity, they are called out state. Okay? These states do not exactly match. Even if you are a weak coupling, they don't exactly match the states that actually you produce with the daggers of the free Hamiltonian. These are states that are stable, in the sense that can survive at infinite time. And the property is basically, let me discuss briefly what the S matrix eventually producing. So to correctly define the states, what you should do is, first of all, not work in the eigenstates of the momentum, but let's consider a physical process where you have like wave packets. And you have, for example, for simplicity, two wave packets, and you scatter them, okay? And because of interaction, they will produce something on three. Now, if you take this state and you go to minus infinity to construct the in state, what will happen is that these wave packets will fly, if you go back in time, to arbitrary large separations. Now, because the interactions by construction of Hamiltonian are local, any interactions between the two wave packets will basically go to zero, because the overlap of this wave function will go to zero till it goes to minus infinity. So any state you could have, if you send it back in time, you will separate into single particles, which are completely disconnected, because they will fly at infinitely far distances, and will basically be free. Will not have any interactions with the other one because they are infinitely distant. So which means that at time equal to minus infinity, the evolution of the state, since all the states are infinitely separated, it's the evolution of a free state. So the full Hamiltonian, this now H is the full Hamiltonian, not H naught and H1, the whole Hamiltonian time equal that goes to minus infinity can be described, can be, well, basically effectively become on state that are constructed this way, wave packets, a free Hamiltonian. Same if you take the time goes to plus infinity, because now what happens? This state will, a time will cross, and at the point they will collide, the interaction will be important, something will happen, but eventually new packets will fly away, and if you wait long enough, they will fly infinitely far each other, and they will be again free. So there will be a t goes to plus infinity, there will be, the state will still be now described by a free Hamiltonian. The important thing is that this free Hamiltonian is not our H naught. This is the free Hamiltonian that describes asymptotic states. Instead, H naught is the free Hamiltonian when we switch off interactions for our elementary fields. And these two objects can be very, very different from each other. A weak coupling, they will have a good overlap, but they're not completely the same. A strong coupling, they'll be completely different. For example, if you, I don't know if you saw something about strong interactions. In strong interaction, your Hamiltonian, in your Lagrangian, you put quarks, but the asymptotic states are protons, neutrons, nothing to do with quarks. But also in electrodynamics, which is weakly coupled, the same is true. In our free Hamiltonian H naught with zero interactions only contain photons and electrons. If you put, maybe you can put also proton, okay? But the free Hamiltonian at infinity with interactions also contain hydrogen atoms. Hydrogen atom is a free particle, and it's not in our Lagrangian, but for sure we can produce it in experiment, it can fly away, and nothing will happen to it. So our Hilbert space also contains hydrogen atoms, helium, all stable atoms, right? All stable bound states, which are not contained in our free Hamiltonian. So what's happening? Why they don't match? They don't match because it's true that each wave packets do not interact with the other one, but you could have self-interactions within the same packet. So if you put the proton here and an electron here, they could be bounded by the interaction terms, and they will fly together.
Yeah, so you are saying that the existence of bound states is the thing that is making them different.
Yes. Okay. Or, for example, where if interactions make some particle unstable. Also in that case, you will have an elementary particle in your Lagrangian without interactions, but it will not be present in the asymptotic spectrum of the free Hamiltonian.
The in-and-out states will be the eigenstates of this free Hamiltonian, but they need not be the eigenstates of H naught.
Of the full Hamiltonian,
yeah.
At infinity. Yeah. Yes. So for example, this is the case for the muon if you switch on weak interaction. Uh-huh. You switch on weak interaction, the muon is there as an elementary particle in your original Lagrangian, but will not appear in the in state and the out state of the Fock space of the full Hamiltonian.
So if any of the in and out states happen to be a single particle state, suppose that it is not a bound state.
So which one? The in state and out state?
Any in state or out state. Suppose that it is not a bound state. It just contains a single particle. So will that state be, you know, having a definite momentum or not? Is it necessary or not?
Okay, let me do two comments. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure it exists. Let's see. I have to think if it exists always a sharp definition of what it is, an elementary particle. Mm-hmm. When you say it's a single state and not a bound state.
So suppose that there is a simple reaction that two electrons are in the in states and electron and positron are in the in states and muon and antimuon are in the out states. So these out states, will they have definite momentum or not?
Okay, so I constructed the S matrix consider these weight packets. Now, what can you now define it in inner states with the eigenstate of the momentum, you ask? Yes, you can, but you have to be careful with the order of limits. So what you should do is to take first these limits to infinity, time, and only after you squeeze the wave packets so that it's an eigenstate. Because if the wave packets are eigenstate of the momentum, they are completely, they are plane waves, so they are completely delocalized in space. If they are completely delocalized in space, it's not true that H1 is zero between two states, because there will always be some overlap. So what you should do is to keep the wave packets finite, make the time goes to plus infinity or minus infinity first, and then only after you take the eigenstate momentum.
But what you're effectively saying is that there can be eigenstate momentum only in the distant infinite far future.
Yes.
There cannot be, okay.
If you have interaction, it's never true that H3 matches with H0. Even the electron, that you will say is a asymptotic state, you will say, because it's a stable particle. The electron that appears here in the free Hamiltonian with interactions at infinity is not the same electron that appears in your Lagrangian without interaction. Because what happens is that with interaction, the electron will still have photons around it, will form a cloud, will have its self-interaction of the photon with itself. So for example, the electron, that is the particle in the in-out state, will have a mass which is different from the mass you put in.
Also the electrical charge will be different.
And also the electric charge will be different. And actually, you will see, I don't know if you will see in the next course, there will be also, it's called infrared divergences, and the only erased if you actually consider a dressing of a shower of photons around a cloud of photons around the electron itself. So it's like the electrons always have some electromagnetic cloud around it because it's charged, and only the full object is actually a good object from the point of view of being in an eigenstate of this the Hamiltonian at T plus infinity, because the full Hamiltonian always has self-interaction. Another way to say it is that the electron itself, if you only construct with C dagger and D from here, is not a Gauge invariant state because it's charged. So you have to dress it with Wilson lines to make it Gauge invariant. Mm-hmm. And these Wilson lines are the photon that goes on.
So the second electron is the one which is physical, not the first one?
The one is physical, is this. This is just a tool, if you want. It will become physical if the interaction is really zero. But if the interaction is really zero, you could never see it. We see things through interactions, right? Okay. Any other question? Okay, so now we go back to our original Lagrangian. I did all this discussion assuming that eventually we can actually do perturbation theory, actually span these terms and keep a final number of terms. If you cannot, then you have really to consider this exponential operator, which I will not know how to compute. So in order to do that, we are implicitly assuming that this dimensionless number E is actually small, and you can expand over it. So, but we cannot choose the couplings of the theory, you just have to measure it. If you're lucky, you're small, if you're not, you're not. So what's the number E that we measure? 0.3.
It depends on the energy, no?
Yeah. Yeah, but low energy is 0.3. Well, is it small? doesn't look that small after all, right?
One
third.
Compared to?
Well, it's a dimensionless number. So we expand, it's a power expansion in point 3.
The powers are going to decrease.
Huh?
The powers are going to decrease always. So small.
Yes, but it's not that small, right? Point 3, if you compute a leading order, you'll say, I'm integrating point 3 squared, which is point 1. And maybe if the factor in front is 3, it's as important as this. Fortunately, we're not that bad, but that unlucky. Because, first of all, one can show that the true expansion parameter is not E, but it's always E squared. And you always come for with extra, typically a 4 pi square coefficient. E squared over 4 pi is alpha. And then there is a typical either a pi or 4, depending on how many numbers. Let me put it like this. Alpha is numerically 1 over 137.36, blah, blah, blah. And 4 pi is another factor of 10. So you see that this factor here is 10 to above 3. So it's in fact pretty small.
And how can we show that?
Very good question. We will see in the actual calculation. One way to see is that the 4 pi square, you can see it in the following way. You can see the 4 pi square from the fact that, so this 4 pi square actually comes from Gauss' law. From the fact that for each charge, you produce an electric field that in radial coordinates as a 4 pi square suppression. So let me see it from the Lagrangian there. From the Lagrangian there, you remember the action was the integral in d4x, the kinetic term, and the interaction term. Let me write this in radial coordinates. Okay? So this becomes r cube dr, and then there is an angle. So this angle produces, don't remember now, in 14. Okay, remember how much is pi. This is some pi square, maybe 4, 2, I don't remember. Okay?
2 pi square.
Huh?
2 pi square.
2 pi square. 2 pi square. Okay, so now with 2 pi square, this 2 pi square multiplies everything. So it's like our field are not canonically normalized. So you can reabsorb 2 pi square by scaling the field. Sorry. So each field divided by 2 pi square, square root of 2 pi square. And also the photon the same. So this disappears from here. And here you get this 2 pi square to the 3 half. Because you can do the same also for f square, which has 2 powers, each kinetic term of the 2 powers of the field. So to reabsorb the 2 pi square from to a canonical normalization, each field has to rescale by 2 pi square to the 1 half. Here there are 3 powers, you get 2 pi square to the 3 half. So the coupling, the effective coupling now is this. Sorry. Times a 2 pi, so it's only 1 half, right? Because there is a 2 pi square in front, multiply everything, and then each one has a 2 pi to 3, so it's only 2 pi to 1 half. And then I only have to show that actually it always enters this square. So you get e square, and the factor of pi is are okay. There's another factor of 2 coming from R, I think. Okay. But you see that the Potter scaling is the number of pi, if you want. They come just from the fact that you are in four dimensions. More dimension you are, more suppression you get. And more, and this is because basically the strength of the interaction, if you have more directions, they will dilute faster because the flux lines have more direction to go. So this 4 pi square always enter. This has to do with the Gauss law, with the fact that the interaction dies faster and faster as you go further and further because the flux line will dilute as you go further away. And the fact that it now appears square, we will see there is a way also by just dimensional analysis to check. It's basically because the perturbative expansion is an expansion in H bar in quantum corrections. And if you reintroduce the powers of H bar that we put to 1 in the action, you will see that this comes with H bar to the 1/2. So in order to have an expansion in H bar, you have 2 powers of E. But we will see in another way when we actually compute.
You can also say that, you know, if you have odd numbers of it, then you will not be able to contract all of it.
Yeah, this is the way we will say explicitly. So at the end of the day, what enters is this small parameter. So the small parameter is 10 to minus 2, 10 to minus 3, depending on the calculation, which means that indeed perturbation theory works quite well for electromagnetism. So already computing the first order, the first correction gives you something that is at the percent per mil level precision. And then if you add another term, you go to 10 to the minus 5, and so on. So to summarize, so in this computation now, if you want to do perturbation theory with this theory for the S matrix. So you expand the S matrix in powers of the coupling E. So we re-expand this expression in the series that we saw before. So this will be a sum of over, if you want, I E minus I e to the n over n factorial, the integral in d4x psi bar a slash d4x1, d4x2, d4xn, time modular product of psi bar a slash psi computed h x1 product psi bar a slash psi computed xn. So it will be a sum, infinite sum, many terms. If you want to work at some level of precision, you truncate the sum at the order you need. Then you have a final number of terms to consider. Each term is a product, a time order product of these operators. Each of these, now we can write in principle in terms of, these are the free fields, so now we can write in terms of C, the dagger, this is a dagger, the expression we already know. And then we have to compute the matrix element between some out state and some in state of all this, and particle state. And then you just use all the convention we worked out, commutation rules, anti-commutation rules between A and C, and you compute this matrix element in particle state, and this will give you the probability amplitude that this state here will go to that state there. So it seems pretty simple now. We have all the elements, just have to take the matrix element. I could finish the course here, because now I could compute everything. But maybe I'll spend more time to go through a little bit more details. Questions?
Is the term here inside the time ordering a product or a sum? The term here inside the time ordering is a product or a sum?
A product. Because it's a product, it comes from the expansion of the exponent.
Ah, okay.
So it would be the product of this. So it's an endpoint function of local operators, which are psi bar and slash psi, on different points. And then you integrate over all points. We'll see how to do this automatically. Mm-hmm. Almost. More questions? Okay, then I'll stop here, and next time we'll see.